Explain to me the scientific, and maybe we'll get to the moral difference, of doing that in a human being in its cell, leave aside animals, which are perhaps easier, and doing it in a germline. What would it mean to do it in a germline?
Right, so you know, if we talk about doing it in an adult, anything, adult person, plant, animal, we're talking about making changes to cells that in ways where those DNA changes are not heritable by future generations. But in the germline, that's a different scenario where now changes that are made to the DNA become part of the entire organism if those germ cells are allowed to develop into an animal, a whole organism. And those changes can be passed on to future generations. So it becomes a permanent alteration. And if you really think about it, it's really changing the evolution of that species at that point.
But our evolution has always changed, right? So what's the difference here?
Here I would say the difference is that we're doing it in a targeted fashion. We're making decisions consciously about, you know, we're going to change this one gene or even a set of genes to do something that we think is desirable.
And the time scale is different.
And the time scale is very
short. Because it would take millions of years. We can now do in about 20 minutes or so. Yeah.
Well, proverbially.
In theory. Thinking.
Yeah.
Start me with the animals. Give me a couple of examples, like baby pigs or whatever, that that science has already been able to use this to do.
Well, there's a lot of examples. So mice, you know, that mice are used very commonly as models of human disease. So it's been possible to make mice that have changes to their DNA that make them more human-like in certain ways, make it easier to study the effects of therapeutics, drugs, for example, on genes. Similarly in, well, you mentioned pigs, you know, so pigs, one of the attractive things with pigs right now is the idea of engineering them so they're better donors, organ donors for humans. And this is already being actively worked on both in research labs, but also in a startup company.
So you basically create pigs that become farms for organs for humans.
That's the idea. That's right.
And so what do you need? What happens to the pigs? What do you do? How do you change their genetic coding?
Well, you can literally, you know, program the DNA so that their organs or certain molecular properties that they have, their immune system, for example, looks more human-like. So you put actually transplanting genes or just altering, making more subtle alterations to their DNA so that they're at a molecular level, they behave in a more human-like way.
And what about like mosquitoes that carry Zika or something? What could you do to help fix that?
Right, so this is another fascinating use of gene editing technology, the idea of gene drive. So this basically just means if you have a way to alter DNA that's very efficient, you can use it, you can set it up in a way that it will drive a genetic trait very quickly through a population, for example, a population of insects. And if one does this in mosquitoes, and this is already being worked on, in principle, one could create strains of mosquitoes that are resistant to viruses and thereby can't transmit Zika virus, dengue virus, et cetera.
But you could also create then just as easily mosquitoes that don't reproduce the same way, that say, you cut back a population of mosquitoes.
Yeah, that's right.
And is that being done in response to the Zika virus? Are you using CRISPR technology yet to take on mosquitoes?
Well, I'm not doing it, but groups are doing it. So this is a very active area of research because I think many people imagine that this could be an effective way to control insects that would otherwise be spreading disease.